Sometimes political jokes get electric. And I will be the first to admit that on that count, I am the chief of sinners. Nobody ever expected me to be elected, both recently and the first time. I have been called unqualified, uncouth, uneducated, unfit, unattractive, just about everything possible, most of which is probably true. But when 4 years ago, when I was elected the first time, it was viewed as nothing short of revolutionary. The opposition claimed that if the Republicans were to take the executive mansion, that there would be war, which we didn't believe. They had all sorts of things that were purported going to happen. The very eve of the election, they said that Stephen Douglas had been assassinated in Mississippi, and that the Secretary of War, that was Jefferson Davis at the time before all of this happened, had actually formed troops and were going to take Washington. And after the election, they said Washington City was in flames, none of which were true. Now, I'll admit, I was elected. It was constitutional, but I was elected with about a 44 point something percent of, I had enough electoral votes, but the opposition was divided. Now, you know, in wrestling, three against one is not good odds, but in politics it is, because they had the majority, but they were divided. A house divided against itself cannot stand. You'd think they would have listened to me 2 years earlier. But nonetheless, by the time I got to Washington, that 40-odd percent had dropped to perhaps 20. And the newspapers claimed that what had taken place in our time was an international scandal, that the civilized world viewed it as an international embarrassment, that we as a people had nothing better to offer for material for the presidency than a third-rate lawyer from Illinois. You know, it was interesting. Eastern papers were saying that I was ill-fit, ill-prepared, ill-informed, ignorant, unable to assume the powers which would be bestowed upon me once inaugurated. But the Southern newspapers were saying that, in fact, I was cunning and crafty and a tyrant who would take away all liberties. Well, they both couldn't be true. I frankly think my election was the summation of perhaps 30 years of general political discontent. And so I will be the first to admit, well, many who have assumed office before me have been better qualified. No one has ever undertaken to fill that office amongst a people, almost all of whom were now opposed to him, and amongst them, a large percentage of which were committed to, well, that'll shorten my speech. Thank you. We're committed to actually overthrowing the administration. So I undertook to fill this office with very difficult circumstances ahead of me. We discovered that in nearly every department of the government, there were those who were committed to its undoing. Not only opposition, but spies, aiders and abettors, informers, suppliers of not only formidable resistance, but ultimately an armed resistance. And they were using freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom of religion to undertake this nefarious deed. And what I finally presented to Congress the following July was this terrible conundrum. Either the government must remain small enough that such rights and liberties would ultimately always be protected, or those rights and liberties would be destroyed by those who were using them, or the government would rise to the occasion to meet the exigency and perhaps even risk losing, in doing so, those very rights and liberties. What was essentially presented to us, my friends, was this ultimate question. Amongst free people, when an election has been peacefully settled by ballots, does that same freedom enable that people to resort to bullets to overturn it? The world has been watching. And so, now, after nearly 4 years of military struggle, I am forced to reflect upon what will be the eventuality of all of this. And it puts me in mind, it puts me in mind of something that I said in New York before I was ever nominated or elected in the city when I was invited to the Cooper Institute. And as I spoke about the Union, I made reference to the uprising that was against slavery, that was illegal at Harper's Ferry. And the fact that the slavocrats, the slave powers of the day, were outraged that anyone should undertake an illegal insurrection, and they blamed it all on Republicans. And just for the record, there were no Republicans actually involved at Harper's Ferry. But then they concluded that the Republican Party must be destroyed as a result. And what I said in New York City, and I'll say again, is what of that? They could destroy the Republican Party, but it was only a form to which a growing public sentiment had resorted over a course of many years. And what we cannot forget is there's no military action, there's no presidential proclamation, there's no judicial decision or legislative enactment which will long be sustained unless it's supported by public opinion. Now, in the present day, we are looking to a soon conclusion of this terrible struggle. And I said to someone very recently, well, even before that, in the second inaugural address, what lies before us is to bind up the nation's wounds and to restore this union and to restore it. In fact, I will read exactly what I said. To do all which may achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves. You see, we have succeeded in restoring the Union, but as I said to someone recently in a letter who asked me what that means, I said, the difficulty is in restoring the Union so as to make it a union of hearts and hands as well as of states. In other words, the original issue that divided us remains. Yes, we have settled by military might the issue of secession. But what was it that caused the issue? Was it not the belief on the one hand that slavery was a moral, political, and social evil, and the belief on the other hand that it was not? Has that dissipated with the dawning of peace on the military front? No, it has not. So how are we to approach the binding up of the nation's wounds when public opinion itself remains the same as it was before the war? How do we restore the Union and make it a union of hearts and hands as well as of states? And that is the grave question that faces us now. I hope to briefly address that, as I did not in my inaugural address. Briefly. I've already surpassed my time. The first thing to remember is, as I said 4 years ago, we're not enemies, but friends. What was it that divided us? A moral principle. Now, how do we undertake to unite ourselves once again? The first thing, I look back on my career as a lawyer in Illinois, third rate perhaps, but before I ever can making a conclusion, I refrained from saying anything until I had thoroughly researched my subject. We live in a time of hot tempers. People who want to be vindictive and make the enemy suffer. We must restrain ourselves. Remember, we may believe that we are on the side of the right, but we must not, like Pharisees, look down on others who disagree with us. If we hope someday to have a union restored so that everyone can be free to express their opinion as I do now, we must also give the same right to those with whom we disagree. Now, right is right. But the public perception of right and wrong is not always a fixed thing. Remember, nearly over 40 years ago, this nation voted almost unanimously to outlaw African slave trade. Why did they do that? Why did we do that if we did not almost unanimously believe it was wrong? We don't make laws against importing buffaloes from the West. And yet, of late, we have heard our Southern brethren tell us that slavery is a moral right. Something changed. Now, how do we proceed? I learned long ago, years ago in Illinois, I was a member of the Washingtonian Temperance Society, and I remember seeing speakers such as I am today standing forth and denouncing the dram and the intoxicants that have ruined families and created poverty and devastation and destroyed marriages. And in denouncing, did they ever win any converts? I never witnessed it. But on occasion, one of their own number, a one-time fellow drunkard, came forth and simply enumerated the blessings of his newfound freedom, the restoration of his family and his fortune and his good name. And in that, there were always those who listened and began to reconsider. You see, if we ever wish to win anyone to our cause, the first thing we must do is convince them that we are their friend. There's an old saying, an ounce of honey catches more flies than a gallon of vinegar, gall. Well, that's the way I heard it. But the point is, a vinegar will do if you can't find any gall. The point is that convincing them is the drop of honey which opens the path to their reason. It's the drop of honey in their heart. But if you begin to denounce them and accuse them of being disreputable simply because they disagree with you, you will close all avenues to their heart and mind. And though your cause be naked truth itself, my friends, sharpened into the hardest steel, shaped into the sharpest lance, and thrown with the greatest accuracy, you will never penetrate them any more than you can penetrate the shell of a tortoise with a rye straw. And so that must be our approach as we begin to rebuild this broken country. Now, we must tell the truth. Mrs. Lincoln tells me I'm a monomaniac on that subject. And we must be careful to make sure that we understand it before we say anything. But remember, our Maker gave us two ears and one mouth. An enormous part of telling the truth is simply listening. And if you listen to those who disagree with you and convince them that you are indeed listening, you will have gone far. And listen also to not only what they say, but what they mean. I remember out in Illinois, well, even before I tell you this, early in the war, I'll tell you how this came up. Secretary Stanton used to get very upset when the governors of the states had quarters to meet. And this was before the draft bill was passed. And one particular governor, I won't say which state, he always met his quota, but he fussed and fumed and carried on, and Stanton and thought he was disloyal. And I said, Mr. Stanton, let me tell you a story. Out in Illinois, I went to a ship lodging once in Chicago, and there was this mighty sternwheeler erected on a track that ran it into the lake. And I was up in the stands next to the yardmaster, and it was all tethered and tied and ready to go. And the band was playing, and all the hoopla was, and suddenly it was quiet. The yardmaster rose, removed his firearm, and was about ready to shoot. But there was a moment of silence during which a young boy, probably, I don't know, 8 years old, scuttled out from the crowd and lowered himself on his belly, feet first. There was a small opening under the boat in the center, about like that, into which he disappeared, feet first on his belly. Well, unbeknownst to me, the great bulk of the weight of this ship was borne upon a wooden trigger, which far down in the underbelly of this ship, there it was located very near the stern. And the boy, when he heard the gun fire, was to lay as flat as possible and kick with all the force he could to free the trigger, and then the great process began as the ship slid over him into the water, where he did it. But as the ship began to move and all the tethering broke, the boy screamed like all the skin was being scraped off his back. I stood erect. I said, what hell was... He said, sit down, Mr. Lincoln. He's fine. I said, well, it sounds like all the skin is being scraped off his back. About that moment, the boy appeared and began giving bows all around. He was untouched. And I said, I don't understand. He said, you see, he always does that, but we always hire him. He does the work well. And I said, well, whatever for does he make all the noise? And he said, oh, he just wants everyone to understand, especially the other boys, that this is a very hard job. And I said, Mr. Stanton, the governor always does his work. He always meets his quota. He just wants you and I to understand that he's doing it to his own political detriment. It's a hard job to send men to their death, I know. You see, if you listen to what is being said, not just in content, but in moment, in meaning, you know what happens? Once they understand, you will give them hope. And my friends, that's what we need right now, hope. I'll conclude with a story. And perhaps some of you have some questions. Early in the war, one of our generals discovered the enormous transforming power of hope. Just on an instant, he was out on reconnaissance with his men. They hadn't gotten very far, but he was troubled with a boil. And I don't know how I'm going to say this with ladies present. Well, it was located in just such a position as to make horseback riding difficult. Anyway, he finally just sent the men on ahead and dismounted, and he was just enjoying the new position of relief when he began to hear what sounded like the rapid reporting of pistols, followed by the return of his own man, followed by what sounded like rebel yells. My friends, I don't have to tell you twice. That man hit that horse in record time and made tracks over fences and bridges and ditches, what have you, until he was safely again behind the Union lines. And you know what happened when he dismounted? He discovered his boil problem disappeared. Well, he concluded there's probably no better cure in the world for boils than the sound of rebel yells. But it wasn't the rebel yells, friends. It was the power of hope for an improvement of condition that inspired that man to instant productive activity. And that is the power of which every one of us must repossess ourselves and communicate to our former enemies. It sounds odious, but my friends, that will restore the Union. So, with having said that, I expect some of you may have questions. I'd be happy to answer if I can. You've been quite patient.